to take it for granted. You know, you're people of the country. You're all here because of country. And that song is incredibly old, and you were privileged to hear it. It's the song of the country that you live on. It was a wonderful, moving celebration of the land. I've got Bunurong, Tasmanian, Yuin heritage. We've also got family at Munta. In fact, the Pascos of Cornwall fornicated their way from here to Lockhart River, where they stopped. The black side of the family were pretty good at it too, but you know, that's my heritage. It's complicated. In fact, my cousin Reggio over here was involved in an email exchange between me and my son where we were talking about our Tasmanian representatives, both related to the same farm. So don't ever say that Aboriginal culture is dead here, because we've seen an excellent example of how vibrant it was when Jack Buckskin welcomed you to the country. It's alive. It doesn't just exist up north, it's here. It's where you walk. I got involved in writing history books because I could never find an Australian history that explained what had happened to my family. How the family was torn apart and then brought together again. I'm a writer of fiction, which is like not having a job at all, really. But I got involved in history because I was really annoyed that the Australian Academy had failed to write it. The photo on the screen is part of the Serpent Dream. This is Mount Goongarroo in East Gippsland, and these are part of the Serpent's Eggs. That is a massive story. It's not just a cute story about a snake travelling around the country. It's about a being who is actually making the country. And that particular journey goes from far north Queensland, right down the coast, over Tasmania, and ends at Rockefeller. It encompasses two-thirds of the land. And, you know, we're talking songlines this year for the NAIDOC Week, and this is what it's all about, how the land is connected. When I was writing a book called Convincing Ground about the contact history, I kept on coming across references to Aboriginal people being engaged in activities that looked nothing like hunting and gathering. And I started to wonder why so many of Australia's foremost thinkers were fixated on the hunting and gathering of Aboriginal people. Until it became apparent that the colonists from Europe, wherever they went, the first action was to demean the people who owned the land, to call them animals, to call them cannibals, to call them non-humans, subhumans. It's written in the legislature of many countries, and it's written in our legislature, because Aboriginal people were fauna and flora. That's what the country thinks of the inhabitants, and that allows Christians to take the land. Thou shalt not steal, thou shalt not kill, but if they're not human, we can have the land. So I was amazed that this information was so readily available about Aboriginal use of the land. And so available that the RIRC were able to make a map of the grain lands of Australia that Aboriginal people were using. And the grain lands that Norman Tyndale and others witnessed, where Aboriginal people had been growing grain, harvesting it, rendering it into flour, were massive. right through the dead heart of Australia, the so-called dead heart. And yet our current Australian wheat fields are represented by those dotted lines, which are down in the southeast corner and the southwest corner. They represent about a quarter of what of the lands where Aboriginal people were growing grain. I went to a momentous event in Mildura a couple of years ago, and actually, you can see the same shirt, eh? I've got two and I'm now just sitting. But geez, they're magnificent hands, eh? 500 games of football and they're smashed to bits. But we were grinding panicum, decompositum. Someone pronounced it differently last night, but I say decompositum. That'll suit me. Anyway, we ground that grain into flour. The Barkindji, the Lachi Lachi, the Muddy Muddy, those magnificent peoples from the Lake Mungo area and the Murray, they harvested this grain by hand, those kids, those bad kids. The kids that no one would have in their school, they harvested that grain. First time in 220 years, and together, those bad kids, we ground it into flour. And then we were instructed by a Japanese man how to cook that in solar ovens that the kids made out of cornflake boxes and silver foil, and we baked that bread on the sands of Lake Mungo. Now, the amazing thing, if you read Australian archaeology, is that you'll come across names like Lurandos. You'll come across Tyndale, who was an American. You'll come across Singh, who was Sri Lankan. Time and time and time again, the people who've done the most in-depth research into Australian Aboriginal archaeology have come from somewhere else. It's a stunning fact. And here we've been instructed in cooking Australian bread by a fellow from Japan. You know, it was a disgraceful day. I love that young fellow. You know, what he did for us and how warmly he interacted with the Aboriginal people, those old worlds from up on the Murray there, Lake Mungo. But why do we wait for a Japanese to tell us how to cook our own bloody bread? When Coles make us get it from Ireland, but surely we can do something about our own country better than that. And there's the bread. Everyone was bloody bawling, I tell you. Next day was going to be Grand Final Day, and we did celebrate that, but on that particular day, seeing that bread come out of the ovens, the Aboriginal bread of that country, and the smell of it. You only had to be within 15 metres of it, and you could smell it. It was beautiful. You know, there's nothing quite like fresh baked bread, but the smell of this is something else again. It smells like Australia. It smells like your country. Will I show you that picture yet? But it was an incredible day, and I went home with a bag of that flour that my sisters had given me. And I took a photograph of it, but I can't show it here because it's so out of focus that you don't know what's going on. There's a bottle of Bogue's beer beside it, because that's the Tasmanian connection. There's the flour, and there's my Wotherong hat beside that, you know. And that was, I put all those things together because they were really important to me. And it was, you know, I was privately celebrating with one stubby of Bogue's.
It wasn't part of the recipe.
No. It is for the cook. Part of the cook's recipe, but not for the food. Anyway, old Bill Gamage, the biggest estate on earth, and an art gallery owner sent Bill a copy of this painting. And it was done by Eugene von Gerard, And, you know, Bill wrote that book about how when we were at school, when I was at school, we were always told that the early colonial painters had no idea how to paint Australia because they were trying to paint it like England, because there were these open green fields everywhere. So that's not Australia, because we've got scrub every place you look. Whereas in fact, as Bill pointed out, Aboriginal people had manicured this land and had allowed open spaces where they grew food. And in this painting here, which represents the coming of the cattle to Kangatong in 1841, the first entry of cattle into that land, they're coming across open plain, and in the background on the left of the painting, there's a field of yellow, and that field of yellow is Murnau, Michael Serres' Lanceolata. And when the early explorers were travelling around the country, people like Sturt, Mitchell, Gray, the Giles brothers, yeah, the murderers, all of these people were talking about how they were coming across fields that were so deeply tilled, there was no way you could ride a horse over it, and you couldn't even walk across it, because the land had been tilled to such an extent. Now, I talk about this in my book, Dark Emu, of which I have several copies. $35, you know, Christmas is round the corner. But I mentioned in that about the tilling of this land, but after the book was published, a young black fella, Jonathan Jones, who is an artist, but taught himself archaeology because he wasn't satisfied with the history of the country either, he went into the museum in Sydney, Australian Museum, and he found boxes and boxes and boxes in the basement of stones of this big, Aboriginal working stone. They were too big and too heavy to work above your waist. You can see the bindings, the binding mark on that stone. Some of them are more complicated than that. This stone had a right, the handle fixed at right angles to it, and it was used between the legs. It was a pick or a plough. Aboriginal people were tilling the ground. There are thousands of these items, and we have never investigated them until the time that Jonathan Jones, young black fella who should have been an artist but decided to write history, goes into the museum and says, "What's that?" And one of the reasons that Aboriginal people were tilling the land like that was because they were growing crops. And one of the crops was microceras of various types, Lanceolata, Scapigera, and we think there's several others that we haven't been able to identify yet, Alpina. I'm getting reports all the time of new varieties of this Murnau or Yam Daisy. And Sir Thomas Mitchell saw Murnau or Yam Daisy growing to the horizon in conjunction with moth orchid and bulbine lily to the horizon. This was crossing the language boundaries of seven or eight different people, getting to the point where the people at the end of that field didn't speak the same language as the people at the start of it. This is an incredible amount of human cooperation in the production of food. And all the explorers saw Aboriginal women harvesting these foods. They harvested those foods until they were shot off the plain. George Augustus Robinson reports that the last harvest that he witnessed was made possible because he, on horseback, with his own gun, rode behind the women to make sure that they could complete the harvest. These Murnau, the one on the left-hand side is the one you eat. The one in the middle is the one that you keep for next season. And you can see it's got the, it's been eaten by a swamp rat. And I have trouble where I grow these with swamp rats because they'll walk past strawberries to eat these plants. That's how good they are, that's how nutritious they are. The one on the On the right is the old original tuba. So you've got grandmother on the right, mother in the middle, child on the left. And that's the story that our people tell about that plant. That's how you look after it. You leave grandmother, you leave mother, you take the child, because next year there'll be another child, and then another child, and then another child. There's a massive story about that. It involves the sky. It's a huge story. It's about the life of the planet. These are not just foods. These are our spiritual journey. My son is a smart fellow, and he'll tell you so. He gloried in the time when he could take a mark over me playing footy. And he used to love calling me old man on the ground. But this is his Murnong garden. And at the time that was grown, that's in its third year now. That was the biggest patch of Murnong in the country. No one else had more Murnong than my son. So these foods were incredibly important to Aboriginal people, but they could also be very important to Australians generally. These just aren't foods of Aboriginal people, they are foods of the country. You live on the country. You can eat these things, but you have to look after the country in order to make them prosper. And I've been saying recently, you can't eat our foods if you can't swallow our history. So you need, Australia needs to adopt its own history, to celebrate the history. I mean, there were murderous times, we know that. It's obvious. The French and Italian and German tourists that come out here and hear the baby version of history that we like to tell them are just aghast. They're Europeans. They know murder when they see it. They know genocide when they see it. They've committed it. And they accept it. Young German people today are fabulous to talk to because they're so open. Because they say, yeah, we did it. My father and my grandfather, they did it. And the whole country accepted it, but we're not going to do it again. They accept their history. If we accept our history, there's a lot we can do. Like, if we had accepted our history, and if we had accepted the land, and if we had accepted the engineering of Aboriginal people, the fish that is in that young lad's right hand would still be alive today. This is a fish at the Burrawarrina fish traps, which had been dammed by Europeans for agricultural purposes almost immediately they arrived in the district. And that fish disappeared virtually that day because its breeding ground is way up the top of that stream. The Burrawarrina fish traps, some people say, are the oldest human construction on Earth. The oldest human construction on Earth, if it was in England or if it was in America, would be visited by 30 Greyhound buses, 10 aeroplanes every day. The Burrawarrina fish traps are visited by nobody. There is one museum there, one Aboriginal guide to take you to see those traps. Australia does not care about what it could be, the oldest human construction on Earth. Such is our desperation to forget about our history that we ignore something as vital to the human family as that. It's not all gloom and doom, because I barrack for Richmond, and I can tell you some truly sad stories. So even though we need to address these things, there's no need to despair. Because I know Aboriginal people from Burrawarrina, young kids, smart kids, and they're determined that this story will be told. And that fish trap was so ingenious that they were interested in the fish. When the orange roughy was discovered in Bass Strait about 15 years ago, we fished it and fished it and fished it until the fish disappeared. We can't afford to do that. It's just stupid. And we need to learn from Aboriginal people at Burrawarrina about looking after your neighbours, looking after the fish, looking after the land and looking after the spirit. I was always told that Aboriginal people lived under a bit of bark and a stick. That comes from part of my family's country up near Lockhart River, made out of jungle vine and canes, clad in straw, beautiful house, and you can see that it could easily accommodate 20 people. We were told that Aboriginal people were beasts. This is a cemetery. In the foreground you've got the gypsum funeral caps, a kind of pottery. And the grace and the care that is devoted to that cemetery and the memory of the dead is one of the things that archaeologists call civilization. It's obvious that right was never given to our people in the early days of Australia. It's time we can do something about it. In the Western District of Victoria after the fires in 2008, a lot of house foundations were uncovered all over the place, and we were talking this morning about some wonderful things in near Geelong, near the Yuyang or Wurdi Yuyang, unexplained features on the land of Aboriginal people. We don't know what they are. We're trying to get our heads around them now, but there's so much to learn. There is so much to learn. I was standing on a fish trap in the Western District a couple of years ago with one of the young brothers, and trying to work out how people could have created such a gigantic thing was just boggled the mind, because there was a lot of stone to shift, a lot of really heavy rocks to move. And I've got another yarn about how Aboriginal people actually moved heavy rocks using poles and twine, but that'll have to wait for another day. Because there's another photo of another Aboriginal cemetery, marked trees, and beautifully kept guard in memory of the dead. There's some more houses. There's some more houses. And you can see the scale of these things. They come from different parts of the country because they were shelters from different climates. In the Western District of Victoria, the houses were built from stone and had beehive roofs. All the explorers, all the settlers talk about these beehive roofs that were made out of clay and straw and sods and had central ribs and poles. You know, these are substantial houses. One of them, the explorer that was, the early settler that was negotiating for the land, went to a meeting in one of them, and there were 52 people in the room. Big building. There you are. Merry Christmas. Anyway, look, it's a big story. You're all involved in it because of the work you do, and it's about caring for country, looking after country, because there's enormous damage being done. But look out here, we put the water back in the swamp. You know, it can be done. It'll never be exactly the same, but it can be done. We can reverse things if we have the heart for it. Not just having the mind for it, it's having the heart for it. And we can, you know, politicians are not going to come up with this idea of their own accord. It's going to be introduced to them by the people. The people have to decide this is what we want. They have to go to the politicians and say, this is the policy we want you to pursue. And the politicians, knowing that this has come from the voice of the people, will balance that against all the other voices and do something about it. That's obviously what happened out here. So I congratulate all of those people, the politicians and the people who were involved in restoring the wetland and those who were restoring the grasslands. I hope that you'll always remember that those grasslands, those yam fields, are part of Aboriginal culture and history. They're part of your culture and history too. But don't forget where they came from. Because when the Chinese and Japanese discovered abalone in Australia and wanted to buy it and are now paying $85 a kilogram for it, Aboriginal people were immediately shut out of that industry. I've got a nephew in jail for stealing abalone, his traditional food. You talk to people on the south coast of New South Wales, they grew up on eating abalone, staple food for south coast people. And in the 1930s, when no one could get a job in Australia, and absolutely no Aboriginal people could get a job, babies survived on abalone, and now we're sent to jail for harvesting it. We don't want this to happen for our grasses. We don't want it to happen for the Murnong. I'm done. Any questions?
Exactly. Any questions?
That book is in its 11th printing since 2014. There's a conversation going on in Australia. Stan Grant had a lot to do with it. Redfern Now had a lot to do with it. Rachel Perkins and all the films had a lot to do with it. But right the way back, you know, Pastor Doug Nichols, all of these people have been saying this for a long, 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 long time, and I think Australia is starting to listen. I really, you know, from the days when AFL trainers would not rub the legs of a black footballer because they couldn't bear the touch of black skin, times are changing. I really believe it. You know, we might muck it up. Look what happened to the, when we were thinking of having, you know, the referendum on the, on how we would run our country. Whether we would, you know, break away from England or not. And after that debate finished, nothing. You know, where is that debate today? Gone. So we might have a peak of interest in Aboriginal issues right now, in the environment right now, but you have to keep that ball rolling because it can disappear more or less overnight just because the price of oil goes down, something like that. We have to make sure that we do it. I think it's happening in the schools. I've got three grandkids. I can't afford to be gloomy about anything. Apart from
Richard. Time for one more, if there is one. All happy? Okay, thanks very much, Brett.